Good evening, everyone from India and Bangladesh. It is a wonderful opportunity for me to discuss something which is very close to both the countries. So, I would like to share my screen. Let me see. Is my screen shared? Can you? Is my screen shared? Can you see my screen?
Yes.
So today, I talk about border. So border is something which separates us for 4,000 kilometers. So the Indo-Bangladesh border is effectively 4,000 kilometers long. Since partition, we have had this border. We have this border which was notional. I will go deeper into the formation of border in some time, but what I'm going to, if you can see my screen, can you see my screen?
Yes, yes.
So yes, this screen is actually a sketch. It is of course not Bangladesh map. It's the map itself, which Cyril Radcliffe had done. Is extremely weird, and there's many many things which we need to really know about this map, which Radcliffe had done in a span of just 6 weeks. He was given 6 weeks to, in 1947, to finish off the map, and that too, we have this notion that the map was built in a form where they were separating the Hindus from the Muslims. This is a very wrong notion. And this is a myth. Because if you see, three-fifths of this Radcliffe line has nothing to do with Hindu-Muslim separation. Three-fifths of this 4,000 kilometer line has Muslims on both sides and Hindus on both sides. So the rest of this line is a demarcation from so the rest of this line, which is one third of this 4,000 meter kilometer line, to be something which has Christians as well as Buddhists for two third of this and Hindus in the rest. So I am going to talk about the map when we talk about border, especially between India and Bangladesh. We kind of think that it is the Bangla border. What I mean is West Bengal and East Bengal or Bangladesh border. But today I'm going to go a little further, and I want to navigate to certain spaces which also is actually circumferencing the state of Bangladesh. So I'm going to talk about borders in Meghalaya, borders in Mizoram also. And I'm also going to talk about Chitmals, ex-Chitmals. Chitmals doesn't exist anymore. There were 197 Chitmals. And I'm also going to talk about Sundarbans a little bit. Besides this, this fenced border of 4,000 kilometers, there's also borders with China, which you can see on the top left is Gurudongmar, Sikkim. So Sikkim is a state which was a country, or rather a kingdom, before 1975. India annexed Sikkim and overthrew the king. And we have a border with China and Sikkim. And basically the Sikkimis joined India. So Gurudongmar is a lake at the extreme north of Sikkim. And I had the privilege of going there, and basically it is a Tibetan plateau where there's no fencing. Question becomes, what is a border? So where is this border? What are borders? Are all borders fenced? No. 1,000 kilometers of the border between India and Bangladesh has water. So it is going through rivers. So of course it is not fenced. Also, I'm going to talk about Nagaland, one place where basically all of Myanmar or Burma has no fencing with India. So why is it that? So it's a very interesting question. These are questions which political analysts should answer, but I'm just going to throw these questions. So I'm going to start off with showing you a small video. Is the video, is it? So this is a place called Bholaganj. This Bholaganj is somewhere in Meghalaya. So after the Bengal border, there comes a little bit of Assam, then the Meghalaya border starts. Meghalaya border is somewhere like 10,000 years back. There was 10,000 or millions of years back, actually, there was this earthquake kind of shift where these Cherrapunji hills had suddenly turned up, which is facing Sylhet. So this geographical boundary, which also creates the heaviest rainfall accordingly for many people in the world, the Cherrapunji hills are basically facing Bangladesh. Is facing the holes of Sylhet. So my investigation was about this place called Bholaganj, where the idea was to understand border. So what does border consist of? So border is all about transaction. Besides people, it is also about transaction. So what we see here in this place called Bholaganj are, you see limestones lying here, and these trucks are actually going to enter the zero point or the no man's land in can you hear me? Am I audible? Yeah, okay. So the idea was, humans are not allowed, but stones are allowed. So you see these truckloads of stones going to the other side of the border, and more, and they're picked up, and so these trucks are carrying limestone, dropping at the no man's land, and Bangladesh trucks are coming and picking it up and taking it to Shela. Shela is 11 kilometers away from this no man's land, Chotok. Chotok is
either speaker there, right or the left of
French Lafarge factory, which is exactly 11 kilometers away. Transaction is also by riverways, as well as an 11 kilometer long ropeway, which is from the British times. So this is very interesting transaction. So who decides this is Mazar, which is inside the no man's land. When I went there, it was a study, and what we found was very fascinating is how does the country secure a border?
Yeah, this fault system is itself is just
so so is, how along countries along the secure borders border. Are through their administration, so
that line
through
on the southern side of the Meghalaya plateau,
bureaucracy basically,
the Donkey Fault,
through your paramilitary forces.
Historically,
and
when,
also homogenizing Bangladesh, the ethnic community
at its time in 1947.
But when I went there in this Shillong Hills, I found at least 16 tribes, Indian tribes present on the Indian side. And our Bangladeshi friends who had also come at the same time.
Geographical and geological conditions also. That's why you are getting one Khasi people in this area only. Because climate is same type cold climate, and suppose you are going to this area, it will be hot climate, and also the settlement will be different. Means food habit, culture. That's why you will get Khasi dominated area here. You are seeing this East Khasi.
So basically, I'm shifting because we don't have much time. So the point being, I'm going to show you now. So we decided. Can you see the video?
I understand. So what is the link of border person? Yes, a person. So we are working.
So this is also the same border. It took me 4 years to actually get permission to go into the no man's land, and now I'm going to walk into no man's land. These are all the BSF chiefs you see. At the right hand side is the Bangladesh. Beyond those lines. And this army is basically grilling me right now because they've just given me permission to walk into the no man's land. So basically the idea was, I took around 10 artists from India and from Bangladesh there were around 15 artists, and we went and met at the no man's land.
Yeah, we've been here a week. How long?
So see how it feels to walk into a real border. This took me 4 years, as I'm saying, for permissions and all the negations. So this is you see the army guy, you see the intelligence officer here, and now we are walking into the border. This is a historic moment, actually.
10 only. I'm going to leave 3 here. 3 only. Too heavy. We got 3, yeah. No, I'll leave 3. You can take this one now.
So I stopped here, and so basically the idea was, because we had put fencing on the Indian side and Bangladesh never had any fencing, so the no man's land actually by default falls 200 feet, 150 to 200 feet inside the Indian territory. So basically those triangular stones, what you saw is the international border, and this 150 feet inside our border is where we have fenced our fences. So the army says we are saving our cattle and our women. That's what the army says, rationalizing how or why they have this fencing. What are they protecting is the question. So the point being, so when I when we managed to go there, many artists from India and Bangladesh, we did performances, we did many kind of installation work, and all the work ended up about labor. We were questioning or trying to understand what this labor force or these people, the general people, doing there. We found out that most of these people have no voting rights on both sides. On Indian side, there's no voting rights because they live on the border. Their plight is just because they live on the Indian side of the border, very close to the border, they do not have any voting rights. So every person who was coming to me was just asking, do you have the power to give me a voting card or something like that? You know, that was the kind of questions we were coming up with. Again, coming back to the Ratcliffe line was meant to be a national line in 1947. It was never meant to be like the national fence. It was a notion. How Ratcliffe had actually segregated the fencing, the border, was by creating effectively 5 different zones. So the Bangladesh, west of Bangla, was actually 16 districts together, and the West Bengal side was around 12 districts. Besides that, there was the Kingdom of Tripura, there was the Kingdom of Kuch Bihar, and there was the enclaves. So this was effectively the border. This was what constituted the border, which later on Kuch Bihar joined India as well as Tripura. So things changed. Also, one funny thing was during 47, what happened was the state of Murshidabad actually thought the district of Murshidabad in West Bengal was thought to be part of Bangladesh. So 1947, 15th of August, they raised Pakistani flag. And the Chitma, the hill tracks, the Chittagong hill tracks, thought they were part of India. And they raised the Indian flags, which after 7 days or 10 days of negotiation, they realized that the Ratcliffe line says something else with no understanding. So now again, there was a huge problem in the Chittagong hill tracks, because they thought it was part of India, and it was not actually. It was kind of segregated. I will now quickly run you through a very interesting part, which we call is... So what you see in front of you is Ongor Pota, which is basically, we talk about the Teen Biga corridor. The Teen Biga corridor is very important and a very unique thing for both parts of the country. We have just entered Teen Biga corridor, and basically this bike which is coming this side is going from Ongor Pota to basically Pottogram. So this road you see in front of me is basically connecting Bangladesh. What I mean is Teen Biga corridor is very fascinating, because this part is Ongor Pota and this is Dohogram, and this is this small tiny road is basically Teen Biga, or this road, and then all of this is Bangladesh. So Ongor Pota and Dohogram is connected by this 300 meter long road or 100 meter long road, which India controls. So from last 60 years, this has been a huge political issue about Teen Biga corridor. And the funny thing is, what you saw, the images, what you saw, you did not see any fencing there. Did you notice? So when I showed you that, when I was going through that car, you did not see any fencing. The fencing started when the Teen Biga corridor was there. So this Ongor Pota and Dohogram has no fencing. So this is what political mindset. So basically, there's a lot of illegal, like cattle trade and all that thing happening. It is easier because there's no fencing. All you have to do is walk across this Teen Biga corridor. And you cannot walk across, you have to take a car. This Teen Biga corridor was also, it was controlled by the Indians at some point. They would say that you would... This is Ongor Pota, inside Ongor Pota. And so now we're zero point. This is inside Bangladesh. So basically this is this is almost like a chitmahal or an ex-enclave. And this is photograph from...
সেমিনার হচ্ছে
সো রাইট নাও উই আর গোয়িং ফ্রম পটোগ্রাম উই আর এন্টারিং দ্য তিন বিঘা করিডোর সো দিস ইজ দ্য বাংলাদেশ আই থিঙ্ক দ্য বাংলাদেশ সাইড অ্যান্ড উই আর গোয়িং টুয়ার্ডস ফ্রম Ongor Pota টু পটোগ্রাম সাইড ইউ আর ইনসাইড দ্য তিন বিঘা করিডোর ইউ আর নট সাপোজ টু ফিল্ম দিস বাট So right now we are going through Bangladesh. Like the corridor is from the Bangladesh side. this is a fascinating thing because this is how borders create power and such things, you know. So so now this road is basically the road from India towards India. So this road is going from one end to the other. That is Indian road. And now again, we are going inside Pottogram in Bangladesh. This corridor is controlled by India. Now we are back into Bangladesh. So from there, I will not go into detail of about Chitmahal, but again, Chitmahal is something which Dr. Sitara mentioned, and Chitmahal is where these 197 small parts of countries which were part of another country. So let's say inside Bangladesh, there were pockets of India, which would start from several few square kilometers to even a couple of houses only. So these are some things which we called enclaves. This was 95% of all enclaves in the world were belonging to this Indo-Bangladesh Chitmahal situation. And so from inside India also, there were pockets of Bangladesh. Now, what we are doing for the last 3-4 years, that is my institution along with Britto from Bangladesh, the Britto Arts Trust, we have been documenting these Chitmahals because these were inside these countries. So basically, a Bangladesh inside India, a pocket of Bangladesh inside India, or the people were not allowed to go out of their demarcated land. There was no facility of hospital, electricity, water, nothing. But they survived as almost equivalent to animals. And what we call as homo sapiens or like bare life. So basically, they were subjugated to worse things than animals. The state would not take responsibility. So finally, after 60 years, in 2015, they did manage to take responsibility and they changed. But now what we are studying is the remnants of their history, because you know they don't want to talk about their past. They are now concerned about futures, and as future is they had certain targets or whatever during their times, and fascinating documents we have there, and how they lived. How do you think you could? So basically it was almost like what we call is staying in detention camps or equivalent to that. So what I am studying right now is how people actually survive these detention camp kind of places, because anyone would go and, you know, massacre them anytime they wanted. So there was no, on both sides of the nation. So these are very important elements of how people survived. So we are trying to document histories and actually tools of survival right now. So now we go back to another place, very interesting place, which is so this is Tlabong. And Tlabong is the Chakma headquarters on the Indian side. So if you see, this is Rangamati, and this is the Kaptai Lake, and this is Tlabong. And what I was fascinated was the ideas of these markets, the village markets. That is why would people cross countries or nations? There were several reasons for it. So one reason was in these smaller towns or villages, there were always very few huts. So a hut would be there on a Tuesday somewhere, on a Saturday somewhere else. So this, what you're seeing right now is I'm standing inside a border So basically a fenced border, and 3 meters away is the Chittagong hill track starting. So I just have to cross this canal, and so this is the border. I can just walk on the other side. That is Bangladesh on your left. So this is a market called Tipparghat, where this was a weekly market. This is a weekly market, and this is inside the fence. So basically this market falls inside the no man's land, and people are allowed to go there. People are already there. The locals are there. We are not allowed. So this is very difficult to actually for us as Indians. Now another fact. So this is an entry gate to the no man's land. So this is open. I'm taking my Jeep inside. So this is Kornafuli river. So border hearts are very important things. I feel. I was reading about this document that the amount of illegal import export to Bangladesh from northeast of India is worth 20 billion. This is a very old report I'm talking of, 2003 report. 20 billion worth of illegal stuff is carried from northeast of India to Bangladesh, according to a 2003 report. And according to Bangladesh, the illegal, 2003 report, is $3 billion worth of illegal stuff happening in both the countries. So this transaction which we were talking about, which I showed you before, is worth only 1 billion rupees, $1 billion in legal sources, but illegally it is worth $3 billion between India and Bangladesh. So why should we not, and we have these two armies on both sides who are so-called guarding our borders and whatever, then why is this illegal trade happening? So there are different questions. I will not get into that, but it is very fascinating when I see again. Now I'm going to something else, and I'm showing you a place called, this is Sundarbans. And this is basically, I come back to Bengal, at the end of Bengal, which is basically Sundarbans. On the left hand side, across the river, is Bangladesh. And this is a couple of months back after Amphan had happened. So you see all these mud banks. This is very difficult to walk. And on the other side is Bangladesh. So this is again that 1000 kilometer long river body, which is also coming from Mizoram to whatever. So on that side, and see, this is a BSF patrolling basically. And on that side is Bangladesh. Now I show you another photo. This is that part of Sundarban where you see on the right are the jungles of Sundarban, and on the left is Bangladesh again. I stop here, and last month a tiger from Bangladesh, from that left hand jungle, had swam all across to India, this side, and all the villagers were banned from going into the forest. And remember, this is post Amphan. So there's nowhere to go. All the migrant laborers are coming back from wherever they were. It is very difficult all over Bengal right now, because Bengal is also full of labor force who are catering to rest of India. So there's hardly anything to eat, and they can't go to the jungle. And because this tiger had come, so it stands still there. And I'm showing you the tip of the last land where humans still survive. And on the right hand side, you see Bangladesh, you see the jungle, which is fenced by this netting, and that is reserve forest. So humans survive however they have to, with tigers or not, or whatever it is. So struggle for survival is very important. And so that's why I also wanted to show, this is also another border where people do have lots of illegal trade or vice versa. Now I shift my focus finally to another border, which is in Mizoram. It is the land of the Maras. Mara is a tribe in Mizoram. And you see, this is a border. This is a fence. So this man just took out this fence. So now I'm comparing the border of Bangladesh to the border of Myanmar. And this is the fence. So you can just go past the fence like that. We're eating food in the night because I plan to go to Burma with these people. They are hunters and gatherers. This man eating is a Nepali who cuts forest there. And we are planning to go to the next village called Humlung. And so these villages are this is the border fencing. Just look at it. So there's no fencing practically. You just walk up and down, and that's the thing. And this is a village across Burma, and this falls into the shadow zone of Burma. So Humlung, this village, has no water supply, has no medical supplies, but they are allowed to come into India to cultivate and survive. Because Mara tribe, like Bengali tribes, Maras are from both sides. They are also in Burma, they are also in India, in Mizoram. So they have this very nice, friendship kind of situation, where cordial relationships, where they come to India to cultivate. And if these people, this village, if they have to go to a hospital, they have to walk 48 hours. Whereas the closest hospital in India would be a 2-hour drive or something. But unfortunately, they're not allowed. So something similar to what happened in the enclaves when someone got pregnant, they had to take a name of an Indian guy or take the identity of a fake father or something like that. That happened in enclaves. So this is, I'm seeing India, the villages, those hills across are basically villages across India. I'm standing here, and this entire, so fascinating to look at India in a very different perspective. So from there, again, the Radcliffe line, what it did was immensely wrong. And like right now, I'm in Longwa. This is a village where they still have kings. And this is how a hut in Nagaland Mon district looks like. And so this king is supposed to be the supreme power. This house is on the left hand side. This man is standing in front of me in the photograph. On the left hand side is Burma, and the right hand side is India. So through the king's house, the Radcliffe line is going through and through. And basically, this king is king of 16 villages in Myanmar and 4 villages in India. And he's a Konyak tribe. He belongs to the Konyak tribe. And this is, again, a photo of the border. And finally, I will show you. I think I'm out of time, no, Nandita?
No, it's okay. It's okay. You can show one more slide, I think. Yes, okay. I think we have a little time.
Yeah. This is a very interesting project. And why I wanted to show you this is a border called, this is the southern tip of Mizoram. So Mizoram is very interesting because the final tip of Mizoram is where Bangladesh and Burma meets. The Indian government has already made a deal with the Burmese government, the Myanmar government, and they have a port in Sitwe port, which is very close to Teknaf port. So India owns a lot of this thing in the Sitwe port, which is just across Teknaf, a little bit down. So now we can ship into Northeast through Burma. This is a long-standing project which has been happening, and it is almost done. So again, a lot of illegal trade used to happen from this part of the thing. So this road, this is not a road. This is leading to Sitwe. So around 50 kilometers more, not 50, 15, 20 kilometers more, and we have Burma on this side. I was not allowed because this is very dense jungle and all that. So I was not allowed to go beyond this. I will finish with one thing. All these borders we are talking about, I was talking about, is even to go to Northeast, if I have to go to Mizoram, if I have to go to Nagaland, if I have to go to Arunachal, for me, I have to take a inner line permit. So I am not allowed as a citizen of India to go into three or four states of Northeast. So I have to take a permission from the government that I want to visit that place. So borders are not only about fencing, it is also about invisible borders and how politicians and people create them. So I will end with that. So I guess, thank you.